Hello, today I will present you our study with the title Pelvic Floor Symptomatology in Gynecological Oncology Patients. What is the true incidence? A systematic review and meta-analysis. Pelvic floor dysfunction covers a large series of different conditions and abnormalities of the pelvic floor that adversely affect the quality of life in women. The number of cancer survivors is increasing worldwide, thanks to advancements in early detection and treatment, as well as the global population aging. In 2018, 43.8 million cancer survivors have been diagnosed during the previous 5 years. The quality of life of cancer survivors becomes increasingly important to healthcare providers as the number of cancer survivors grows. Gynecologic cancer care also requires various treatment modalities that alone or in combinations have the ability to damage the pelvic organs and contribute to pelvic floor disorders. The incidence of pelvic floor dysfunction in women who have been treated for gynecological malignancies has not been well described. The aim of our study is to compare the incidence of pelvic floor disorders in women before and after different types of treatment for gynecological malignancies. We hypothesize that the prevalence of pelvic floor disorders in the gynecologic cancer population will be higher after the treatment. We searched Medline, Embase, Global Health, the Cochrane Library, and Web of Science through April 2021. The search strategy includes only terms relating to or describing the intervention. The keywords were pelvic floor disorders, pelvic organ prolapse, urinary incontinence, stress incontinence, overactive bladder, frequency, nicturia, gynecologic cancer, vulva, cervix, vaginal, ovary, and endometrium cancer, treatment, surgery, chemotherapy, hormonal treatment, and radiotherapy. We include only studies with histologically proved gynecologic cancer and valid data on prevalence of pelvic floor disorders both before and after any oncologic treatment. We exclude case reports and case series, letters, editorials, and reviews, and all the studies with no clinic data on specific gynecologic cancer. Our primary outcome was to determine the prevalence of pelvic floor disorders in gynecologic malignancy intervention. Our secondary outcome was to determine the deterioration of pelvic floor disorders in women after therapy for gynecological cancer. Of the 550 studies derived, only 11 met the criteria for systematic review. The prevalence of pelvic floor disorders in 663 survivors of cervical cancer was evaluated in 9 studies, and in 37 vulva cancer survivors in 2 studies. There was no studies dealing with patients with endometrial or ovarian cancer that met the criteria for this systematic review. Treatment for cervical cancer increased the rate of stress urinary incontinence from 14.2% to 33.7%. Also, there was statistically significant increase of overactive bladder and mixed urinary incontinence pre-treatment to post-treatment. The overall prevalence of urinary incontinence in cervical cancer survivor was also significant increased after treatment. There was only one study that evaluated the fecal incontinence before and after therapy. Although there was a mirror increase of fecal incontinence, this was not statistically significant. Only 2 studies examined the prevalence of pelvic floor disorders before and after therapy in vulval cancer survivors, and only the total urinary incontinence. 37 women participated in both studies, 4 of them diagnosed with urinary incontinence before oncological therapy, and 9 after. This slight increase was not statistically significant. There were many studies that examined the pelvic floor disorders on endometrial and ovarian cancer survivors, but none of them compared the pre- and the post-treatment prevalence. We tried to make meta-analysis for cervix cancer, but the limit of studies with control groups all controls with pre-treatment and post-treatment valid data make the meta-analysis not possible. Although there was only two studies for vulval cancer survivors, both of them used control groups to compare the pre-treatment and post-treatment effect on urinary incontinence. The number of cases and controls are few, but they are enough to make the meta-analysis possible. So, as you can see on the diagram of meta-analysis, there was an increased risk of urinary incontinence after the therapy for vulval cancer than the therapy for VAN. In conclusion, the prevalence of urinary incontinence increased exponentially after any intervention for treatment for cervical cancer. However, the quality of data regarding this field is suboptimal. The main concerns are the pure design of the studies, most of them report of only postoperative symptoms, the infrequent use of validated instruments to quantify the pelvic floor disorder, and last, the inclusion of multiple cancer in many of the studies that do not discriminate the type of disease and the type of interventions, as the treatment approach is different between the various types of gynecological cancer. Also, pelvic floor disorders are common in gynecological cancer survivors and should be discussed with them. There is a lack of studies that compare the pre- and the post-treatment pelvic floor disorders. Future studies should focus on prospective assessment of baseline prevalence and the impact of specific oncologic treatment modalities on pelvic floor disorders using proper assessment like validated questionnaires, pelvic floor ultrasound, and urodynamic study. Our systematic review highlights the need for more comparative data on pelvic floor disorders among gynecological cancer survivors before and after therapy and the use of control groups.